Oh,
now try.
Good morning. Would you please stand as we sing and testify to the goodness of our God, His faithfulness in our lives, so we have testimony for others to hear. Who are we that you would be mindful of us?
We've got no music, Heather.
No music.
Oh. Hang on. Sorry, guys.
Thank you.
knowing every victory was yours.
Hearts be receptive and their minds be understanding of the words that you have chosen to be shared today, Father God. We praise you for that. Lord, I ask a blessing upon those that protect our land, our military as they're in service, those that have served already, Father. I just ask you to continue to bless their lives and those that have paid the ultimate sacrifice for our freedom, Father. We just thank you for them. Lord, those are among us that are ill right now. I've heard of one today that had an issue this week, and Lord, we just lift up Milo to you, and we speak blessings into his life and total healing into his body. And those that are not with us today, Father, I ask you to bring them back safely to us next week. Lord, we thank those that are new here visiting us today. We ask that they be blessed by your word today, Father God, in all that you do. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen. As you take your seats, watch your eyes as Karen turns on the lights and Rebecca makes her way up here.
Good morning, everybody. We are so glad to see so many of you back and joining us, and several new faces as well. just the normal string of announcements. If you feel compelled to give today, there is a basket right by the door, or you can give online at findtransformation.com/giving. You can text the word transformation to 830-293-4483, or you can give on our app. If you are on Facebook and you'd like to check in to let your friends know where you come to church and maybe they want to join you, go ahead and check in and make sure to click the 125 Lehman Drive location so they know where to find us. We are happy to pray with you at any time. Prayer is a powerful, powerful thing. You can text the word prayer to 830-293-4483 and fill out a prayer request that way. We have prayer request cards on the back of the transformation cards right outside the door, and you can put it in the basket there. We can pray with you in person. We're happy to pray with you any way that you need it. And like I said last week, make sure as we're getting ready to go back to school that you're praying for those students and those teachers and all the administration and staff that goes in order to put on the school year. If you don't have our app yet, I know I've mentioned this twice already, but it has some great things on there. So if you don't have our app, go to either the App Store or Google Play, and you're looking for Church by Ministry 1. It is a purple icon with a white cross in it. Once you have that downloaded, you can search for Transformation Church Kerrville. You have access to sermons, ways to contact us. You can put in your prayer requests. We have Bible study sign-ups. You can give on the app. So all great things there at your fingertips. If you need help downloading it or if you have any questions, please just find one of us and we're happy to help you do that. Blessing of the backpacks are going to be on August 14th. We would encourage any school personnel, any kiddos, to bring their backpacks, and we'll pray over the students and the teachers and all of their belongings that will be going into the school on that day. Maybe, was the school supplies on that one?
No, you can talk about it there, though.
Okay, school supplies. I'm going to pause for just a second. Hopefully you noticed the bucket as you came in. There's a big silver bucket that you can put any school supplies that you feel to donate. And that'll be going to Ingram Elementary School. Last year we donated 10 backpacks and they were gone within the first week. This year we're shooting for 20. So I know some of you have designated funds to that. Thank you for that. We will go shopping on your behalf for school supplies this week. 21 Days of Prayer and Fasting starts on August 7th and it runs through August 27th. If you are a morning person, this is for you because you start praise and worship at 6 o'clock. Mr. Richie's ready to go, and I know that. Really, it's just a wonderful day to start, a wonderful way to start your day. And there's a praise and worship time. Pastor Chris Hodges, they're out of Church of the Highlands in Alabama. This is where it's run through. He gives a short message and kind of a challenge or a prayer category for you in the day. But amazing things happen when you commit them to prayer. So 21 days of prayer and fasting. If you have more questions, you can ask us, or there's also a link on our website that gives you a little more information. Freedom Group, we are ready for another semester of this amazing Bible study that is also put on through Church of the Highlands. But we host a small group at, or we don't host, Mom and Dad host it at their house, but we host it. It's all there. And it is a wonderful 12-week study that will be on Tuesdays this year because we felt that more people could actually enjoy it and come on a Tuesday. And so far, it's working great. So you can sign up for that through the app. Or if you want to just tell us and we can put your name on a list, that's fine too. But it is a 12-week study that then ends with a conference that just kind of realigns your priorities with Christ and allows you to feel his freedom. So I highly recommend that. Again, Dad is taking questions for September 25th. He's dedicating that service to questions that you have about the Bible or Christ or anything. He would love to do the research for you ahead of time, so make sure to get your questions into him for that day. And next week, it'll be about the return of the King, and it's a 6-week series that deals with end times, prophecy, and the return of Christ. So week one will start that for us next week. But I'm going to pass it over to Dad for the next generational obligation.
Thanks, Beth. Give her a hand if you would. She does wonderful stuff. You know, a couple things I'm going to reiterate on the announcements that you talked about. We are not part of Church of the Highlands. I use resources the Church of the Highlands puts out through an organization called ARC, and that is the Association of Related Churches. It's amazing when independent churches that preach the Bible can get together and use their power for resources. And that's part of what really keeps us as an independent church the ability to do things like this, to offer more, to supply more to our people, because we think that, number one, we love you and you deserve it. So we make that an offer for you. Couple things real quick that she didn't talk about that I want to talk about is, a couple weeks ago, I preached about how we all are to share the gospel. Remember that? Those of you that were here, great. One of our members, Tim Jones, has been a friend of mine for a long, long time, took it upon himself to order some books called The Four Spiritual Laws. If you ever have a problem sharing the gospel, we have them on the front desk for you. Pick some of these up and just hand them to somebody. This does a great way of explaining what the salvation story is. It's an amazing thing. And, you know, growing up, we used to call these tracts. We used to get tracts. Well, this is done through Campus Crusades for Christ. So that's where Tim grabbed these ones. But it's really powerful. So if you're interested, there's a stack of them out there. Grab a couple of them. Pass them out. We'll order more. We'll get them in here. And we're going to give you everything in your arsenal to be able to share your faith. And let's grow this place even more. We seat 100. I'd love standing room. Then I'd have to go to two services. And we're all for that. So just let you know. The other thing, part of the ARC, what ARC's offered us, has anybody ever heard of an organization called Right Now Media? Okay, Right Now Media is a Christian-based media source that has videos and Bible studies and lessons and things for kids. It's a really incredible thing, and a lot of big churches use this for their small groups or use this for their people to have. Well, because of our association with ARC, and us being a rather new church plant through them, we have 1 year free for all of our members, okay? So what I'd like you guys to do, and this is something that you're gonna have to try, if you log in to the app, you've got to get us your name, your address, phone number, email address, because I've gotta send out some of this information to you in an email. But your account will be free. There's a lot of things on there. We're going to be able, as a church, to do some things as well. So over the next couple days, if you can, you know, if you don't download the app, call me, and we'll get you on our CRM, our client retention management system, so we have all of that information. Okay? Fair enough? Great. So good morning. We are so glad you're here. I get to start off the day like this. We want you to know how much we love you, and I think you guys know that, right? We love you? Really? That's all I get? Okay. Well, we do, and we're excited that you're here and you're choosing.
We love you too.
Thank you. We're excited that you're choosing to worship with us at Transformation Church. Our prayer is that we are able to teach you how to love God deeper, how to love other people, and how to live out the life that He has designed you specifically for. Because you know, you're the only one that He's designed that life for, right? You can't be like somebody else, and somebody else can't be you. He made you specifically to do something. All right, we're thankful again that you're all with us today. So, did anyone take me up on my challenge last week? Did anybody read a psalm a day for 7 days? I see head nods. Yes. Did it work? Did you like it?
Yes.
It's kind of enlightening, isn't it? So, I'm going to keep that challenge fresh. You guys, what the challenge was is just for 7 days, read one psalm a day. Just do it. It will change your attitude. It will change your life. All right, our scripture today, it's going to be on Psalm 78. But since it is a 72-verse scripture, we're not going to go over it in its entirety. But I want to start with verses 1 through 8. That's where I got the title of this message today. So let's look at that together, if you will. Psalm 78, 1 and 8. It says, "My people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things from of old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he has done. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach their children so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. They would not be like their ancestors, a stubborn and rebellious generation whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to him. So today we're going to be talking about what may be the most important season of life. It's when children are in the home, when kids are still around. Arguably, the most important segment of our society is those under 18 years of age. They're the most vulnerable, the most teachable, and they have the potential to live longer than the rest of us do. So our current investments in this group will impact generations to come. With that said, I'd like to talk about the power of influencing the next generation. I want to talk to you about what I would call, or what I've titled, the next gen or the next generation obligation. All through history, God has provided and issued a next generation obligation to people of all faith. All throughout history, God has said, teach your children in every season. Jesus told us the first and greatest commandment was to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And the second is to love our neighbors as ourselves. I'm sure that if there was a third great commandment, it would be pass on your love of God to the generation that follows you. Can I get an amen? Okay. Teach them to know him. Teach them about him. Teach them to love him and live for him. And to let others know about him as well. That's the challenge and the call for our next generation. One day, under the direction of the Holy Spirit, there was a worship leader by the name of Asaph. And he decided his great contribution to God's kingdom would be to pass on his faith to his generations. In the process, he showed us how to do it so well. Let's take a trip together back about 3,000 years or so, 3,000 BC. David had just became king of Israel, and he wanted to move the capital of his kingdom to the mountaintop city of Jerusalem. If this city was going to be the center of his kingdom, then it had to be the center of his worship as well. What this meant was the Ark of the Covenant had to be moved. And in order to do that, because the Ark of the Covenant was where the Spirit of God hovered over day and night. Throughout the Old Testament, we've seen story after story of what happens with the Ark. So David organizes a big group of people to have a big party as the Ark is traveling. So if you look at 1 Chronicles 16, 4 and 6, it says, he appointed some of the Levites to minister before the Ark of the Lord, to extol, thank, and praise the Lord, the God of Israel. Asaph was the chief, and next to him in rank were Zechariah, then Jaziel, then Shemiramoth, then Jehiel, then Mattathiah, then Elab, Benaniah, Obed-Edom, and Jehiel. They were to play the lyres and the harps. Asaph was the sound of cymbals, and Benaniah and Jehaziel, the priest, were to blow the trumpets regularly before the Ark of the Covenant of God. So here's Asaph. He's this guy who played the cymbals. Now, I don't know if they were finger cymbals or big clanging cymbals. I don't know. But he was the one that made that kind of noise as they brought the Ark into the city that we now know as the city of David. Now let's take a look at a second P piece of history. The kingdom of Israel lasted for 400 years before it was conquered by the Babylonians. And the Babylonians slaughtered most of the Israelites and then dragged the rest of them off into exile to the outskirts of Babylon. 70 years after this happened, the Babylonians were conquered by the Persians. And the Persians released the Israelites to return to their homeland. And the Jews returned in droves. The description of those who returned in the second wave is found in Nehemiah 7. Nehemiah 7:7 says, "The list of the men of Israel." And then the list goes, and I forgot to put the number, just pushed through there a couple of times. The list goes on and shows over 80 groups of different parts of the tribes that went back to Jerusalem. And if you go all the way down to verse 44, you see the musicians, the descendants of Asaph, 148. Here's what I wanted to show you. Asaph played the cymbals in 1000 BC, and 148 of his descendants were singing to God 500 years later. One day, a mere cymbal player thought about his children and their faith. He wanted his sons and his daughters and their sons and daughters and their sons and daughters and their sons and daughters to love God as much as he did. So he wrote the words to a song, and that song became Psalm 78. The words in that song preserved the faith for all of his generations for 500 years. What kind of words could do that? Let's look at them together. Starting back again at Psalm 78, 1 and 3, if you have your Bible, you'll see at the top of the psalm, it says a maskil of Asaph. Now, a maskil means a teaching psalm. This is a psalm that's going to teach us something. Specifically, it's going to teach us to teach our children. So 133 says again, "My people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things from of old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us." Translated, I'm going to retell some history, some God history, some things we know about God have been passed down to us from prior generations, from the people who experienced them. Why am I going to do this? Because I'm convinced we have a next generation obligation. So what's our obligation? I'm going to share it with you right now. There's three things that I want you to know about today. The first of our next gen obligations is to pass on our faith to those that come after us. Continuing, the things our God has done in Psalm 78:4, it says, "We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he has done." Our children need to know who God is. And the best way to show them is to tell them what he's done. There's a current movement these days in our country, and maybe you've run into it. Parents saying things like, "I'm not going to influence my kids about God. I'm going to let them make their own decisions about him when they're old enough. They can figure it out for themselves." Only they can't figure it out for themselves. God is invisible. They can't see him. The way to find out about God is through revelation. If any of you saw my video this week on Facebook, I said something about what I call the four-generation fade. The first generation, parents don't make church a high priority for kids. The second generation, those kids grow up and make it less of a priority for their kids. The third generation, those kids grow up and they make it no priority for their kids. And those kids grow up with no concept of God. Zero. None. Four generations. God revealed himself to us through Jesus Christ coming to earth to see what God was like. And through Scripture, he tells us stories of God's actions so we can understand what he's like. Letting your kids figure out God on their own is like, I'm not going to teach my kids about what foods are good for them. They can wander around the kitchen and figure it out themselves. You're not going to last a long time on Twinkies and Ding Dong. Our kids are going to be exposed to all kinds of misinformation about God. You can see it today, can't you? The lies that are being spread about who he is. If they don't hear the truth from us about him, they may never know the truth about him at all. Asaph decided to teach his children and our children. Think about that. He wanted to teach them about God. And to do that, he told stories about God. Stories about what God had done in the history of his people. That's what Psalm 78 is all about. Let's look at verses 5 and 6. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach their children, so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born. That's us, just so you know. And they in turn would tell their children. When did he do that? When did God do this? Mount Sinai. God gave the law and the Ten Commandments. Psalm 78:7, Asaph continues, then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. So the second of our next gen obligation is this. We must teach God's deeds to our children, so that they will put their confidence in him. Everybody puts their confidence in something. If we teach kids what God has done, then they will have confidence in him. Psalm 78:8, they would not be like their ancestors, a stubborn and rebellious generation whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to him. You see, the first generation that heard the law at Mount Sinai didn't believe it. They had a crisis of faith. God told them to conquer the promised land, but they refused. So God let them die in the desert. Then in the book of Deuteronomy, he gave the law again. And the second time, their children believed and they conquered. You see what Asaph is doing? For 72 verses, he's doing what we should all be doing. He's telling them, the children, about the wonders of God who made them, who loves them, and who is with them all the time. Asaph is passing the history of his people on to the next generation. Here's some more history. It's going to give you a little greater context of this next group that we're going to talk about. The nation of Israel was made up of 12 tribes. We know that, right? Three of those tribes were Joseph, Levi, and Judah. Joseph was the favorite son of Father Israel. His tribe became the largest and most important of all the tribes. So large, in fact, that it was twice as large as all the other tribes. When it came time to divide up the land that they conquered, the land of Israel now, the tribe of Levi wasn't given any land. They were the priestly tribe. Their job was to lead worship, to make sacrifices in the temple. So their livelihood, the tribe of Levi, their livelihood was derived from the land, was not from the land, but from the tithes and the sacrifices that were made in the temple. The tithe was for the priest, not others. Meanwhile, the largest tribe was going to need the largest portion of land. And since Joseph's tribe was the largest, it became divided into two tribes. Joseph had two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. The firstborn was Ephraim. Now, we know Jewish history, the firstborn is supposed to get it all. That's just the way it was. So stick with that memory for just a few minutes. All right, so the tribe of Levi serving as a special function as the priest, God broke the tribe of Joseph into two tribes. Again, the tribe of Ephraim and the tribe of Manasseh. So they're back to 12 tribes now since Levi doesn't have one. With this background, let's continue. Psalm 78, 9 through 11. The men of Ephraim, the firstborn, his men, though armed with bows, turned back on the day of battle. They did not keep God's covenant and refused to live by his law. They forgot what he had done, the wonders he had shown. Again, everyone puts their confidence in something. If we teach them about God, they'll put their trust in him. But it brings us to the third point. Let's put it that way. Our third point of the next gen obligation is this. We need to teach God's deeds to our tribe. It's our people. We would call it our family. Let's look at verses 9 and 11 again. The people of Ephraim did three things wrong. Verse 9, they turned back on the day of battle. You see, they didn't believe God would fight for them. So they acted in fear, not in faith, and they turned back. Verse 10, what did they do? They refused to live by his law. They were morally corrupt. They did not believe in his law. And verse 11, they forgot what he had done. All throughout Exodus, God worked wonders in Israel. But the Ephraimites, they saw it. They were there when it happened. The next verse tells us this. We look at Psalm 78, 12. It says, he did miracles in the sight of their ancestors in the land of Egypt, in the region of Zoan. See, Zoan was the capital city of Egypt. The Egyptians called it Tanis. The Ephraimites watched God deliver Israel from Egypt during the 10 plagues. Remember that story? They were there. That tribe witnessed this. But when it came to battle, they forgot it. They forgot his faithfulness, and they shrunk back to faithlessness. Asaph continues in 78:13. He divided the sea and led them through. He made the water stand up like a wall. Y'all know this part of the story. God parted the Red Sea. Why? Because God is a delivering God. But Asaph wanted to remind the children of this. When his children are trapped, when your children are trapped, when your grandchildren are trapped and have no place to go, God always provides a way out. Always has. Always will. Psalm 78:14. He guided them with the cloud by day and with the light from the fire all night. Why did Asaph say this? Because he wanted the generations to know that God is a guiding God. Once they got out of Egypt, they headed they had nowhere to go. They didn't know where they were headed. They just were leaving Egypt. So God led them by day and he led them by night. He never leaves us to wander on our own, church. He is a guiding God. Verses 15 and 16 says, he split the rocks in the wilderness and gave them water as abundant as the seas. He brought streams out of a rocky crag and made water flow down like rivers. Again, he's teaching the generations that God is powerful and providing. He split rocks open in the middle of a desert to provide water. He was faithful to Israel all throughout the Exodus. Asaph is showing the next generation what God is like by telling them the things that he has done. Again, this psalm is 72 verses long, and we're not going to be able to read them all. In the verses that follow this, Asaph continues to tell stories of God, feeding them manna from heaven. And when they got tired of manna, he sent quail to provide them for their food instead. In fact, verse 27 says this, he rained meat down on them like dust, birds like sand on the seashore. Can you imagine how many quail that is? And he did it every day because they got tired of manna. Yet even after all of that, Asaph points out verse after verse. Let's look at verse 32. In spite of all this, all those things that he had shared that God had done, in spite of all this, they kept on sinning. In spite of his wonders, they did not believe. Friends, you know what? We serve a forgiving God, a loving God. God. A God that wants all of us to come to repentance. Asaph continues in verse 36 through 39. But then they would flatter him with their mouths, lying to him with their tongues. Their hearts were not loyal to him. They were not faithful to his covenant. Yet he was merciful. He forgave their iniquities and did not destroy them. Time after time, he restrained his anger and did not stir up his full wrath. He remembered that they were but flesh, a passing breeze that does not return. Even when they were not faithful, God remained faithful. Hope is for all of us today. Church, how many of you have said something in a situation, God, if you help me through this, I will never fill in the blank? You don't have to raise your hands, but did you? Did you again? God didn't destroy you, did he? He's merciful. He is faithful. He realizes we are but flesh. 41 through 43 continues. Again and again, they put God to the test. They vexed the Holy One of Israel. They did not remember his power. The day he redeemed them from the oppressor. The day he displayed his signs in Egypt. His wonders in the region of Zoan. When they forgot what God had done, when we forget what God has done, we start living by sight, not by faith. Asaph is teaching a lesson about God to the generations to come. He's using stories to do it. Stories of God's faithfulness and stories of people's unfaithfulness. It's not to say that sin is okay, because we all know it's not. But it's to say that even in sin, God wants you to repent and he loves you. This is a psalm worth studying because it teaches us how to pass on our faith to the next generation. Now let's skip all the way down to the final chorus. It starts at verse 67. Remember the earlier reference of Ephraim turning back. The firstborn got denied. Asaph explains why the Messiah came out of the tribe of Judah and not from the firstborn's tribe. 67:72 says, "Then he rejected the tents of Joseph. He did not choose the tribe of Ephraim, but he chose the tribe of Judah. Mount Zion, which he loved, he built his sanctuary like the heights, like the earth that he established forever. He chose David, his servant, and took him from the sheep pens. From tending the sheep, he brought him to the shepherd of his people, Jacob, of Israel, his inheritance. And David shepherded them with integrity of heart. With skillful hands, he led them." The city of Jerusalem sits high on the Mount Zion. It's in the territory of Judah. David, the king, is from the tribe of Judah. Jesus Christ, the Messiah, is from the tribe of Judah. God chose the tribe of Judah because the older turned away. They lost faith. They lost faith because they forgot the things that God did for them. Church, this just goes to show you that how important it is for us to remember what God has done for us. I'm talking personally now. Not what he just did when he brought the Israelites out of Egypt, but what has he done for you? It's the whole ballgame. We are called to walk by faith, not by sight. We can't see God, so we have to trust him without seeing him. We can't see, but we can hear. And we can remember what God has done. And when we remember, what happens? We trust. And when we trust, we walk by faith. One day, a cymbal player named Asaph looked at his children and said, "I want them to walk in faith. How can I help them do that?" His solution was to tell them the story of God's faithfulness. That one technique, that one practice was so effective that his children's 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 children were still singing God's praises 500 years later. Friends, there is a God who is with us, and he is faithful. But he's invisible. You can't see him. But you can see him through what he does. You can see him provide for you. You can see him protect you. And he can comfort you. And he can encourage you. Tell your children. Tell your grandchildren about his works. Tell them about the works of old, the things that we read in the Bible. But tell them more specifically about his works in your life, what he's done for you. how he's helped your family through the generations. Your family, make it personal. That's your obligation and mine. Asaph's solution to passing on faith was simple and effective. If our kids are going to love God, they have to know God and what he's done. So I'm going to teach them some history. Real quick, let me give you a few suggestions on how to pass on your faith to future generations. The first is teach them what God has done. The Bible is brimming with stories of God's guidance and provision and protection. Tell those stories and get your kids into programs that tell those stories. Keep the stories and realities of all that God has done in front of them as much as you possibly can. And as you're teaching your children about what God has done, number two, teach them that God doesn't change. Hebrews 13:8 said, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. It doesn't change. What he has done in the past, he will do in the future. What he's done for the children of Israel, he will do for your children and your grandchildren. Then along with teaching kids about what God has done in the Bible and in your own life, number three, teach them what God has done for your family. Tell your children about how you came to know Christ. They may have never heard it, but share it. Tell them how he led you to your job. Tell them how he provided for you when you lost your job or didn't have a job. Tell them how he led you to your spouse if you have one, and if not, something that he's done for you. Teach your children how God brought them into your family. Tell them how he formed them in their mother's womb. It's in the Bible. Teach your children how God watched over them and protected them when they were little and when they were sick. Now, I know there's a lot of dads in this room. What are we good at? We're good at telling stories. Some of them made up. But your own personal story, tell your kid. Tell your kid how you got to where you are. Share your struggles. Share the pains you had, but then the joy of what it is like now that you've come to know Jesus Christ. We're easy for us as men to share what our favorite team has done, or share who their latest draft pick is, and can't wait for the next season to start. How about the team of God? Share it. Grandparents, tell your God stories too. Children need to hear it from multiple generations. That shows them, that proves to them that it's not something new. He's been around for a long time. And those without children, you have a next generation obligation as well. You can do this by shaping the faith of our future generations, by your volunteering, work with youth in some way. Remember the words of Asaph in 78:4 again when he said, "We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord and his power and the wonders he has done." So when you're at home or you're on vacation, heck, even if you're just driving to the grocery store, tell some God stories to your kids. Some from the Bible, some from your life. Around Christmas, share with them the Christmas story and what it meant and why it's such a miracle. Next spring, you get to teach them about the resurrection and how much of a miracle that was in and of itself. And in the fall, teach them about God's faithfulness in every season of your life. Teach. Keep the stories of faith alive and well in your family. So what story are you going to pick this week? What story in your mind right now is God sharing with you that you can share with someone else? Do it. Listen. And let Him guide you. Who are you going to tell it to? When are you going to tell it? Personally, I don't think planet Earth will last another 500 years before Christ returns. I don't know. But wouldn't it be wonderful if it did? And your children's, 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 children were playing cymbals and singing His praises when He returned. Amen. You bow your heads, please. Father God, thank You. Thank You for Your word. Thank You for your guidance in our lives. And Father, teach us. Teach us to share You with all these future generations. Let us be bold enough to stand for You in our families. To take the lie of the enemy and get rid of it in our families. Let's start there. And as we teach our children and grandchildren about You and what You've done and how effective You are in our lives, let them boldly share that with others. We can take back this world that is possessed with evil to Your glory, Father. It's been done before. We're no different today. We have that opportunity. And I ask You to let the Holy Spirit flood each and every one that's here today or listening online. Flood them with more of You. Give them the examples of what You've done in their lives so they can share it with every moment. And if it's not their own kids or grandkids, let it be somebody else's. Just share the message of hope. Share the message of salvation. Lord, I thank You for that. You are so merciful. I thank You that You have not ever changed. That You are the same today as You were yesterday and will be tomorrow. A loving God. A faithful God. A God who wants nothing more than for His people to repent and turn back to You. The gospel is all about that. Repentance. Turn from our wicked ways and back to You, Lord. Jesus, I thank You. I thank You for the opportunities You give me to provide Your word, to inspire others to love You deeper than they ever have, or if they don't know You, to love You, to start there. You're an awesome God. Father, if there's anyone in this room right now with all heads bowed and eyes closed, if there's anyone in this room right now feeling the tug of the Holy Spirit that they want to be in a deeper relationship with You, allow them to raise their hand now. I'm not going to call them out. Just right where they're at. We thank You for that. It's a relationship that You're working on, Father. It's a relationship that You want to continue. It's a relationship that You want to build a life around. Thank You. For the rest of us, as we prepare our hearts for communion today, if you will just repeat after me. Father God, thank You for providing a way to Your perfection. I'll never have it on earth, but I will with You in glory. Thank You for sending Jesus to cover my sins, to make a way to You for everlasting life. Prepare my heart today, Lord, to receive You and guide me over this next week to teach others about You. In Jesus' name, amen. Does everybody have communion? If you don't, raise your hands. Karen will get it to you real quick. Okay, everyone's got some. Great. If you'll peel back the top where your wafer is and take your wafer out for just a moment, like I do every week, I'm going to tell you the significance about this little round piece of bread. See, this represents what Jesus did with His disciples in the upper room on the day of what we now know as the Last Supper. That day he took bread with his disciples and he broke that bread and he said to them, "Take, eat, this is my body which will be broken for you." They didn't understand him. They didn't know the meaning behind it until after the fact. But he wanted to show them what he was willing to do for them. To be broken. To be the last sacrifice. He said, "Every time you take of this bread, remember me." Then he took the cup of wine, and after giving thanks, he told them, "This is the blood of the new covenant, which has been shed for the forgiveness of sins." Remember, church, to be forgiven of sins, you had to make a blood sacrifice of an animal, of a lamb, an unblemished lamb. That day, Jesus Christ became the unblemished lamb, the final sacrifice for the forgiveness of sins, past, present, and future. And he told them, "Every time you drink of this cup, remember me." Goodbye, heads again. Father God, thank you. Thank you for sharing a meal with us, a communion with the other saints that have gone before us, Father. A time to remember who Jesus was and what he did. A time of renewal, a time of refreshment, a time of thanksgiving. You never cease to wonder, me, Father. The words you choose, the ears you choose to hear, the hearts that you choose to change. Lord, I lift them all up to you today. Those that were visiting, Father God, I just ask that you let them find a place they love. And if it's here, we'll take them with open arms. Lord, I love you, and I thank you for the opportunities you provide. Bring everyone safely back to us again next week, Father. Watch over them. Heal those of us that need the healing. In Jesus' name, amen. Go forth into the world loving God, loving people, and living your design. See you next week.